When I was 6, I joined a team called the Venice YB. It was on this team that we first met. There was Brett, there was Khi-Min, and then there was me. Khi-Min was the only one who knew what he was doing. Brett was always stressed out because his dad was our coach. And for some reason, I always found myself on the floor. None of us knew what YB stood for, and we really didn't care. All that mattered was having fun. Back in elementary school, Khi-Min moved just 2 blocks away. I remember I saw him during recess, and because he was the new kid at school, me and this other guy started chasing and telling him we were gonna whoop his ass. But of course, he has a different story.
There was this girl walking, a little girl, and you guys started messing with her. So I told you to stop, leave her alone, and you guys started chasing me.
He told the principal, and we ended up in her office.
I didn't tell on you.
After that, we became best friends and did everything together.
We would just hang out all the time. And then we heard Brett was moving, so he moved into the neighborhood.
When my family moved in, we moved right in between, so we're literally like 3 blocks away from each other.
We used to sleep over one of our houses, either mine, Brett, or Taz, like every night, and we kind of messed with Brett because he was new.
We weren't really picking on him. We just wanted to help him out.
Yeah, we was helping him get tough. He wasn't soft, but he was just kind of soft-spoken. He wasn't like us.
You guys were just being mean, but I think in the long run it did help me because I was really shy and I did need to open up more. As we were going to school, I mean, the whole time we kept playing basketball with each other, and that was something that also held us all together.
As your team grew and the families got closer together, you guys were more curious to know what is Yellow Brotherhood, the concept of Yellow Brotherhood beyond basketball.
But in order to understand Yellow Brotherhood, we first had to learn about a gang back in the 60s who called themselves the Ministers. Ministers ran the streets of LA's Crenshaw District.
They didn't do drive-bys and they weren't killing people or robbing people. They were kind of the outcasts, and so they found like community and family within each other. Gonna show why. I don't know if you're gonna show.
The original Ministers were loyal to each other and their community, but by the 70s, the second generation of Ministers became loyal to drugs.
There was like a drug epidemic in the community. There was no leadership, institutions, or even outside help that knew how to deal with it. That was the climate that the YB originated from.
This was during the time young people were questioning things, demonstrating for not only their rights, but against the war in Vietnam. And so the consciousness of America was changing.
We are the migrant worker. We are the offspring of the concentration camp.
Everyone's getting politically aware, so that inspired the Ministers to get the drugs off the streets that was killing all the young people.
Inspired by the social movements of the late 1960s, and in response to the rampant drug problems in the Asian American community, the original members of the Ministers started a self-help group, formed to help youth get off of drugs and stay out of gangs. They called it Yellow Brotherhood.
Since they did have the street credibility of being like gangsters, they used their influence more towards improvement.
We gained their respect. The younger people really worked hard at trying to at least get rid of the pushers in our community. We got the young people organized into doing fundraising events, so we used to have car washes, and we were able to raise enough money to buy a house on Crenshaw.
YB house set, we started to organize the Asian youth in the community.
We'd have a tutoring session, and then we go camping or we go to Manzanar.
They started organizing basketball teams in different leagues.
You didn't feel that separation like, oh, this is, you know, it's Yellow Brotherhood, it's only for the guys, you know, because it was pretty, in numbers, I think it was pretty equal. It was fun and it was a real good learning experience.
It was an exciting time to live that time. And, you know, I'm glad I got to participate.
Despite all their efforts, they could not keep up with the epidemic. Eventually, the YB house became less like a community center and more like a halfway house. There were overdoses, fights, and finally in 1972, a YB member was shot and killed. A few months later, they sold the house.
You know, everyone went their own ways. Someone went to the army, one of them went to, you know, started working. Some of the girls went on to college. I mean, everyone just kind of just parted.
When the house was in existence, you know, we had basketball teams. So the basketball teams continued. During those years, I got married with children. Like a lot of people that, you know, I work with within the movement, they had kids the same age as like Brett, like your parents, Bob and Karen, like Kim and Sandy.
And so the parents already had some kind of connection with each other, and the basketball was sort of the backdrop for people reconnecting and deepening those bonds.
And when we did start the Venice YB team, I felt it was important to use the name YB because of what I felt that the YB has always stood for.
Keeping it real. As we learn more about the significance of our name, YB became more than just basketball for Brett, Khi-Min, and myself.
We didn't know that before we started playing YB that all of our parents knew each other.
Later on, when we learn about like the history and stuff about it, I mean, it's like an honor, you know?
It basically represents what YB represented back in the 60s and 70s. This whole sense of like this team is an extension of your family. Your family's an extension of our community.
Nick and Ken would always stress people taking care of each other, looking out for each other. The team started to develop this identity of, you know, it was a continuation of Yellow Brotherhood.
We became like the old Yellow Brotherhood in other ways. Just like the original members in the 70s, we began to encounter societal and personal problems of our own. In 1992, director Spike Lee released the film Malcolm X.
And around the time when the movie came out, I think my dad and Kenwood got us all X hats.
At the time, it was like only black people were wearing these X hats. And when we did, people thought, you know, why are you wearing that hat?
There was some education about who Malcolm X was and the significance of wearing an X hat.
Malcolm X talked about being proud of who you are, and I think every nationality has like a really deep history that they should be proud of.
Around the same time we were developing our political awareness, both Khi-Min and I started having problems of our own. Even though I'd grown up playing basketball, football was my real game. And when I got into high school, that's all I cared about.
I remember Tad was struggling with school and really couldn't understand it, other than like just that his passion was for his football and his sports.
Tad's dream was to go to UCLA, mine and him both. We both really wanted to go there and we wanted to do it together. For a little while, it didn't look like he was gonna be able to make it.
I always wanted to go to UCLA, but with my grades, it looked hopeless. At the same time, Khi-Min was having struggles of his own.
I started running with the wrong crowd, getting high, smoking weed, experimenting with other drugs, and that caused a lot of problems.
It was serious to the point where, like, this could really affect his future. So yeah, I was pretty concerned about him.
I got this close to getting kicked out.
I'm like at the end of my rope. I'm ready to send this boy off. So it got to the point where, you know, I called like a community meeting.
Everyone was over and then we all voiced our opinions, and I know it helped having everyone there and just to show our support that we all cared about Khi-Min.
Brett and Tad, they knew what I was doing was wrong, but they didn't judge me. They had my back and they were there for me, you know.
So we all met, and interesting enough, no one else supported the idea of sending my son off. And that's the truth, I'm laughing about it. In truth, YB saved him, you know.
Hey, Nick, open it up here. Okay, oh, looking good, all right.
It's like you guys were sharing the same things that they shared, growing up together, growing up in this environment where everyone's really close.
We celebrated things and we also mourned things. No matter what the occasion was, when you guys graduated from middle school, when you graduated from high school, there was always something to celebrate.
When we celebrated high school graduation, there was so many people there, all these friends and family that are so proud of us, me, you, and Brett.
It was really nice because everyone who was important to us was all there. You really got a sense of how much everyone cared about each other.
There are times when you'll need someone. I will be by your side. I take my chances.
And I remember going to the back in the fireplace and everyone telling us how proud they are.
Right at the party, you know, I was feeling guilty. Looking back at what I put my parents through, because I saw the people there and all the love that was in the room and all support we had.
It was like a true sense of a community. Everyone was just there for each other, you know.
Even though years have gone by and we don't see each other as often, the feeling of brotherhood we shared still remains. YB was more than just good memories. YB taught us about respect and caring for others. And most importantly, we learned that community is not out there to find, but up to us to create.
Where I'm from, brothers took the beats and got fly.
Why? That's most asked by 85 where I'm from. Faking the funk, you get dead. Projects, tenements, pyramids where I'm from. We're living off that boom boom crack. It's that hip hop rockers jazz when I'm max. Peace be the greeting of the insect tribe. Pestilent forces can't catch the vibe. We live to love and we love to rock mics. We speak in ghetto tongue, cause ghetto's the life. Food for thought, so get a buffet plate. The lyrics are so fat, you might gain weight. So just watch me step alone into the sunset. Left foot, right foot, 1-2 mic check. Brewing funk inside my soul kitchen. So pull up a chair, here's a bit, have a listen. A hard hit intervene.
Damn, I know you fluent.
Yeah, cause Doodle ain't having it, and Butterfly knew it. Where you from?
Yeah.
Doctors, engineer, in a pair, right?
Yeah.
Hip-hop made a point last year, right?
Yeah.
But planets is the joint this year, right?
Yeah.
Planets cop the duds and lift to grass hop. Duck out from the fuzz that sweat the hip-hop. Rising like we foam, get it from the dome. I'm from where the fat beats stretch for mad blocks. We can get a kick without no breath. Feeling funky beats go straight to the head. Fall into a club, dig on what we love.